Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Santosh KC. I'm from BiCoO3's National Lab. Today I'm going to talk about first principles and neutron diffraction investigation on polarization of bismuth cobalt oxide. This work has been done with Babington and Cooper as well as Lee, an experimental collaborator. As I said here, the polarization is bismuth cobalt oxide, but I'll be more focusing on spin-driven polarization. So first, I'll give some outline of my talk. First, I'll give you a brief introduction. So I'll talk about first a brief introduction of my multiferroics, and then the motivation on studying this bismuth cobalt oxide, starting from bismuth ferrite structure. And I will be first talking about ground state properties, including electronic magnetic polarization and then spin-driven polarization. And then while explaining the spin-driven polarization in bismuth cobalt oxide, I'll go into other crystal structure, R3C and R3M, because they have a different, there is difference on octahedral rotation in this space group. And then I'll try to give some route to enhance spin-driven polarization in this material. So in this community, we already know about multiferroics, so I'll not spend more time on here. So as we know, in multiferroics, we have coexisting magnetism and ferroelectricity, and there is coupling between these functionalities that make those kind of materials novel, and it has various potential applications in devices, for example, information storage, spintronics, sensors, logic, and memory devices. So, but those multiferroids are very less in number. So, there has been widely studied on bismuth ferrite as a multiferroid material. So, first I will talk about bismuth ferrite. Here it shows the crystal structure of BFO. It has Z-type antiferromagnetism, and it has, this is a 111 direction, it has a polarization, and then it has also a spin cycloid formation. So this is typically a type 1 multiferroid where it will have magnetic transition temperature is lower than ferroelectric transition temperature. And in this material, recently, in our colleague found out that spin-driven polarization is large, that is close to 3 microcoulomb per centimeter square. So this, and then it was experimentally observed using a neutron scattering experiment. What is done is you have distortion using neutron data, and then you are fitting higher temperature data with gingerbread value that doesn't have magneto-electric coupling. So the difference will give you the spin-driven distortion. So using that distortion, you can get the spin-driven polarization. So it turns out that the experiment matches with the theoretical prediction. So from this, we were motivated to study other transition metal oxides. So instead of iron, we're trying to replace with cobalt, chromium, nickel, manganese, and trying to see which has the higher spin-driven polarization. So to do that, we use density functional theory, and I use a BNI ab initio simulation package, and we are using LDA plus U. And we also compare our result with the neutron diffraction experiment. So first we look into the ground state property of those materials. So here we can see chromium, bismuth chromium oxide, manganese, cobalt, nickel. So all of them are they are semiconducting in their ground state. So among them, let's see magnet that is stabilized in ferromagnetic orbit, whereas others are in a different anti-ferromagnetic orbit. So when we look into the distortion, then distortion to estimate the spin-driven polarization, they have a chromium that it has a very tiny spin-driven polarization, and others also not much. So, but among them, bismuth quark oxide, it has significant distortion, spin-driven distortion, that means larger spin-driven polarization. So we focus on this to study spin-driven polarization. So here you can see the crystal structure and magnetic orbit. This is C-type anti-ferromagnetic system, and it has a significant band gap with the dip. Then we change into ferromagnetic orbit. Also, it retains the band gap. So first we studied the total ferroelectric polarization, and it has large ferroelectric polarization that is more than 150 microcoulomb per centimeter square, and this can be explained by the structure that is super tetragonal, that I see over A is 1.27. Then we try to estimate the spin-driven polarization in this material. So from we have some methods that we can extract spin-driven polarization by just comparing the anti-ferromagnetic orbit and ferromagnetic orbit. And it turns out that it has 2.59 microcoulomb per centimeter square. That is comparable to bismuth ferrite. So bismuth ferrite that has like octahedral rotation, but it doesn't have any rotation here. So without rotation also, bismuth quark oxide in ground state has a large spin-driven polarization. So now we have neutron data. So neutron data also shows that it has C-type anti-ferromagnetic ordering, and it has Nile temperature personally K, and using those data, we can estimate the polarization around 166 microcoulomb per centimeter squared at 300 K. So DFT is also giving like similar results, though it may vary depending on U, choice of U, and the functional use. So we have the distortion as a function of temperature from Newton data, and from here we can confirm that there is large spin-driven polarization, but we haven't refined, we didn't get the refined data to get the accurate, quantitative accurate spin-driven polarization number. So now, so this is ground state, stable ground state crystal structure. So what happens if we change if the crystal structure? Because we saw that BFO, that's R3C space group, and it has octahedral rotation. So if we introduce that rotation, can we enhance the spin-driven polarization? That's the main question. Also, like we had ground state structure of other materials like chromium, manganese, and nickel as well. Can that be enhanced by transferring to R3C phase, just like BFO? So now let's see other spin-driven polarization numbers we have from literatures. These numbers are very small, and these are type 2 multiferrites. You can see BFO, that's the type 1, it was the record high till now. So when we studied the bismuth quark oxide, I explained few slides before, it was also comparable to BFO. So now let's go to RTC phase of these materials, including bismuth quark oxide, chromium oxide, and so on, and see if it can increase the spin-driven polarization. So before that, let's learn something about RTC phase. Here, this polarization is because of symmetric breaking, due to this distortion along 111 direction, and because that breaks the inversion symmetry. And there is another rotation, anti-ferro distortive rotation this way and this way, and that also breaks the local inversion symmetry. So let's see what happens with the with this structure if we convert that bismuth core oxide and other structures. So first we look into the electron D structure. This is bismuth core oxide. This is antiferromagnetic. This is ferromagnetic. Both retain like this semiconducting gap. And chromium oxide also retains semiconducting and cobalt as well. But however, mangan and nickel, these are metallic when we transfer into R3C phase. That's the rhomboidal phase, just like BFO. So we neglect these two, and we keep focusing on chromium and cobalt to get the spin-driven polarization. So let's see the numbers. So in R3C, we see that there is octahedral rotation, and chromium, it has close to, it's less than 2 microcoulomb per centimeter square. Whereas this is iron and this is cobalt. Cobalt is like significantly higher as expected, more than we expect. So this was like interesting, just introducing the octahedral rotation, we can enhance the spin-driven polarization. Then we want to know what happens if we stop this rotation, we freeze the rotation and see what's the polarization to understand the coupling to the octahedral rotation. So here it shows the R3M phase, that's when we freeze the rotation, and we can see that spin-driven polarization is reduced. So it clearly shows that there is robust coupling with octahedral rotation to enhance the spin-driven polarization. So next, this is a summary of what we observe. So when we convert, when we change the spin configuration and expand the spin-driven polarization in bismuth cobalt oxide that has the highest spin-driven polarization so far, that's close to 10 microcoulomb per centimeter square. And when it was in R3M, it was at 3 microcoulomb per centimeter square. So there is huge enhancement because of this coupling with the octahedral rotation. So this is great, but can we achieve this experimentally? That's the another question. So we think that that's possible, probably using strain. So epitaxial strain can induce this R3C phase for bismuth cobalt oxide that has large spin-driven polarization. So the energy difference is small, the 30 milliEV for formula unit, and around 3.4% is tensile strength, that is very large, that can induce R3C phase. So that has highest spin-driven polarization. So in conclusion, we explore some of the bismuth metal oxide compounds to identify high spin-driven polarization. So we found that bismuth cobalt oxide has the has the comparable spin-driven polarization with BFO, without even octahedral rotation, and which was confirmed by neutron scattering, though it was not given the qualitative aid. Changing structure to R3C phase even enhanced the higher spin-driven polarization. That is due to coupling with octahedral rotation, which was seen by comparison with R3M structure. So finally, we predict that R3C phase can be stabilized by the epitaxial strength. So finally, I would like to acknowledge DOE, Office National Lab, Merckx, and our engineer Cooper. I want to acknowledge early career award. Thank you.
It's time for questions. Yes.
Maybe it's a really naive question, but I was just wondering why you can give more details about how the comparison between ferromagnetic and anti-ferromagnetic is spin-driven polarization.
Okay. Yeah. That's a nice question. So I think I have an extra slide here. Let me show you here. You can see here, you have like antiferromagnetic, the polarization and ferromagnetic, and we have this relation, so we can first get this C coefficient, like this, and then we can aid the spin moment and get the spin driven polarization. So instead of getting from this paramagnetic, we can get from paramagnetic and anti-paramagnetic. So that this details is given in a PR paper I was giving in the introduction.
Oh,
that, no, no, that is not confirmed.
Okay.
That is not done.
How much strain do you need to stabilize it?
I said 3.8%.
3.8.
So we need to find the suitable substrate.
Thanks. Any more other questions?
Yeah.
Yes, if not, let's thank speaker again. Jeff Lee.
Yeah, which one is yours?